Jimmy Odegard,
Yeah.
how's
How
it
are you?
going, man? It's been several years, several years.
Quite a bit.
I'll give a quick introduction here. This is Backstage Community Forum. I am here with Jimmy Odegard, legendary singer of the metal band Disturbed.
You said legendary singer. I was wondering if Bill Lindsay was in the room.
No, but yeah, you did Disturbed, you did God Awful. Were you in Deranged
Basically the
originally?
same band. They just legally couldn't use God Awful anymore, or
Disturbed.
Disturbing. Or would we even want to? That name is kind of dated. You know, when I first heard that band, I heard that monkey squawking song like 99 when it first broke. Didn't care for it, you know. And I was in someone else's car, and I can't tell him to turn off his own radio. And that song came on, I go, God, these guys suck. He goes, you know what they're called? I go, no. They're Disturbed. And said, you gotta be joking. It'd be one thing if they kicked ass, but I don't. If you guys are a fan of that stuff, knock yourself out, but it just never feels good.
Well, so what happened with that? Because you guys had the you guys had put out a record on Channel 83, and I'm guessing that that was copyright. And so what happened?
So,
Was it the time lapsed or something like that? It's where they were able to get the name?
we're a bunch of potheads and never copyright, you know.
We learned how to copyright from you, so I
Yeah, I
checked
mean,
ours.
there's proof we existed long before them. You can't fight Warner Brothers. We talked to an attorney about it, and he says, you're barking up a big tree. And nor do we care. You know, we gave that name up before those guys are allowed to leave the house again. And like I said, it sounds dated.
When you talk to people locally,
Yeah.
Disturbed, they don't think about that band. They think about you guys, you and Earl, and you had a bunch of Bahamut was pretty much a staple in that, but
Yeah. I'll still get from people. I heard you were Disturbed at one time. We're not talking the same way. No, it's a lot of times people, like I live out in a rural area where a lot of people don't. It's Slipknot and Korn. That's metal, and that's about
That's the extent of
maybe a Led Zeppelin thrown in there if they're home. But
it
really got no one to speak to about it. Really, handful of people. But
then.
yeah, we gave that up a long time ago. You know, it got awful. Started up. I wanted to call the band Horse Labor. A lot of hard work for nothing, basically. Earl didn't like the name. And Earl seen his parents and told him that, yeah, me and a couple of bandmates are getting back together. And his dad goes, what, you play that god-awful music? And great name. Let's use it. So that's what we went with. So.
And now, who all was in that band? That was you.
John Miatich, who was one of the original members of Disturbed at the very beginning. Two younger guys, Andy Hintz and Joe Soderquist, is the drummer. Andy is now a member of Arch Allies tribute band.
Oh, okay, right on.
They're kind of in the same bed with Hairball. And I believe Chainsaw runs in both, but this is more of a classic rock thing than
Yeah, they do like
glam rock.
Journey and
Yeah,
that kind of
Heart
stuff.
and whatnot. They have a female singer. They'll do lead forward.
Oh,
They're
that's
very
cool.
good at what they do. They're very entertaining. Joe, I'm not sure what is happening with him anymore. Wasn't a band called they were cute. They probably got paid and laid quite a bit. But and John's somewhere up in northern Minnesota shooting guns at turkeys out his back door. And Earl's no longer with us.
Yes, but
Missed the
he's
guy. Think
here.
about
He's
him
here in
daily.
spirit with
But
us
that's
all the
right. I noticed that when I first walked in the room. That's an old. Now, where did that get smashed at?
That got smashed. The first metal, the metal for man's best friend.
Okay.
Do you
Yeah.
remember when he smashed that at all?
He smashed quite a few. He'd buy them at garage sales and whatever, and then just set the good one aside and grab the bad one and just crack it over a pole at Ryan's or something.
So when he was selling, after he closed the record store, yeah, I only lived a few blocks away, and he had a garage sale, and this was sitting underneath the table, and I'm like, Earl, is that the guitar that you broke at the
Yeah.
and he said, yeah, I'd like to Have it turned into a lamp or something like that, you know, some art. And I'm like, well, what do you want for it? He goes, I give me 10 bucks.
It still exists.
I gave him 10 bucks and it's been through, you know, two
It's lucky you
marriages,
didn't
three
take out an
houses.
eye or something, you know, cracking that thing on the floor and parts go flying and potential lawsuit.
Well, that first metal for man's best friend, that was a big deal for me. That was the first time walking out on the main stage, and that was a lot of fun.
Yeah, happy to have you on that too. I remember we caught some flack from some other local bands that we took you guys on. Animosity Inc. was talking about. Had you guys play a show at 7th Street Entry with us. We sold it out. The place was elbow to elbow.
I got the shoot
And
on that. It was like over 200
they
people
blamed them.
there.
Yeah, you took them because they'd bring their entire high school with them. And it's like, yeah, you're right.
Yes, you are.
So we had Richfield High School basically in attendance, you know, and a handful of our old friends. But yeah, that gig itself helped propel us a little further career, if you can call it a career,
I think it's a career.
our existence. But you know, it always costs money. It most of the time lost money. We weren't in the business of generating money at this. It's really lost money. It was fun while it lasted, but 63 now, I couldn't imagine doing it anymore. I walked off stage. I was 15 years old. The very last time I ever played was at Station 4, forming Ryan's in St. Paul. I walked down that staircase to the basement after we were done. It just basically collapsed on itself. No more energy. That was it. Plus, no one wants to see a guy with bald spot in the face. I had my day.
Hey,
Film was
I'm
nice.
singing one song next week.
But now there's guys that are now in their 50s, early 50s. They're still at it. And it's like, man.
Well, I think it was an incredibly tight niche, whatever, that we were a part of. It was the metal stuff, and
Well, it was something new.
It
Like,
was
in a way, it was something
different. It was I think that entire thing was all carved out.
new.
We didn't have any bosses telling us what to do. If some club didn't like us, we just didn't play there anymore.
That's right.
You know, and because it brought the crowd that wanted to see our music to wherever the venue is, it'll let us play, whether it's, you know, back room at McCree's
Not enough of them
pub
shows.
or
What was that place on Lake Street? It was like on Bloomington Lake. Fernando's, yeah.
Fernando's,
We had a show there that the police got called to. We evacuated really quick. I got into some verbal confrontation with the guy running sound, and he mixed us something awful. And our drummer Mike destroyed the kitchen afterwards. He said the police got called. We're throwing cabinets and drum sets in the back of Camaros, and anyone pick up and throw them in.
Oh, that was so much.
Needless to say, nobody went to
Now you didn't even start out living here. You come from the
middle of nowhere.
middle of nowhere, just to the left of the middle of nowhere.
Yeah, I live in East Dakota, I call
East Dakota.
it. It's about as visually stimulating as Oklahoma. But anyway, I knew Earl and ran into him a number of times in the past. I mean, it wasn't Minneapolis has grown a lot in the last 35 years.
Oh,
So
yeah,
it was
absolutely.
a much smaller town. So I'd ran into Earl a few times. I actually met Earl at a Robert Plant concert in like 82.
Really?
And
Met
it was at the
Center?
old Civic Center.
Oh, the Civic Center,
And
gotcha.
I was tired. It was hot out that day. I had worked that day. I'm underneath the bleachers laying down. And he comes walking up to me and asks me if I'm okay. He thought I might have fallen or passed out. I'm okay. I'm just chilling. He had a Judas Priest shirt on. I had an Iron Maiden t-shirt on. We were the only two metal heads in the building. And so we began talking. And then I learned that he lived down the street from me. I'd see him in passing once in a while. One night at Mr. Nibs. He had a bunch of people come over for an after party. And his former band, Deranged, rehearsed in the basement. And someone jumped behind the drums and he plugged in a guitar and someone else played bass and asked me to sing. So, okay, great. So we got up and fucked up Metallica songs and Judas Priest songs, whatever, Motorhead songs. And he said, "Yeah, you do pretty good at that." Well, that incident alone that evening caused his bandmates to get a sour taste in their mouth over it and threw him out of the band. So about 2, 3 weeks later, I seen Earl and, "What's going on, man?" I said, "Well, them guys quit on me, or they threw me out." It's like, "You should start something." So it's like, "Hey, it's an opportunity. Why not?" And so we attempted. I can't think of the damn band's name. Oh, Disturbed. Yeah, that's what that sounds like.
That's
Brainwork.
amazing.
But
you're distancing yourself from the name so much that you're forgetting
yeah.
it.
So that's how that got going. And then we had a handful of guys come in and out the door at Red Bird. But then the first lineup to play on stage was Greg Bleeker, who has a music store up in Little Falls, and he has a cover project. He asked me about a year ago if I wanted to do a Cheap Trick tribute thing. And I just said, "Time, distance, and age can't do it." And honored to be asked. I love Cheap Trick too.
Yeah,
Sing along to that stuff in the car.
me
But he's up there. Mike's in town. I'm not sure if he plays drums any longer or not. He was our Mike Nelson,
Mike Nelson.
drummer of that band. John Mayakich. For a while, John wasn't John Cook. I'm sorry, John, or Mr. Cook, I guess. But he was in the band briefly and actually wrote some of our better riffs and better songs.
Now, what did John, what did Mr. Cook play?
So Ron Cook,
Ron
that's it.
Cook.
Yeah, Ron, he was a guitar player.
Okay,
Really,
so
really good, yeah.
okay, was it when did you, so was that the lineup that did the Channel 83 Disturbing the Peace LP?
No, different guitar player. At that time, we had a guy named John Sweat, who lives out in Denver.
Okay.
I haven't had spoken to him in at least 10 years. I'd seen him about 25 years ago. I was out in Utah mountain biking and on the way back stopped in Denver where he'd been living for the last 40 years and stayed a night and visited for a while. But otherwise, I haven't seen the guy. Oh, no, I did to Earl's benefit at First Avenue.
Oh,
He
yeah.
came to town. And I haven't physically seen the guy since, but a mad genius. Incredible talent. A mind like you wouldn't believe, but crazy.
That's the
Not
best kind.
dangerous crazy, but
That's the best
fun
kind.
crazy. Yeah.
That's the best kind. And
Yeah.
that was the guy that was on, that's who, that was the lineup on the Disturbing the
Yeah,
Peace.
yeah.
Okay.
No. That band kind of fell apart. People lost interest. Things happened in our lives might have annoyed one another, and the band just kind of evaporated. And ran into Earl at First Avenue a few months later, and he asked me what I'm doing and if I'd be interested in resurrecting this. And okay, so we got on the ball. I think Ross from Soylent Green suggested Mike Bowden,
Oh yeah, Mike. Yep.
and then Jason Merkins, drummer, now lives in Houston.
Oh, does he? I didn't know that he
Yeah,
moved.
he's been
Okay.
going up 10, 12 years now. He's
Okay.
was our drummer. Bass player was Ken Olson, another
Yep.
Ridgefield guy
He
from
was,
your era.
yeah,
Yeah.
Kenny
Yeah,
Olson.
I haven't spoken to Ken in a long time. That was the first lineup of Disturbed.
And that's when we played with you, and that's when you had the Don't
Yeah.
Expect Any Miracles cassette that you
Yeah,
put
he
up.
was on that. That disc got or tape got around the world. We used to keep a we used to we printed on the inlay of the demo.
Yeah.
Send us correspondence if you if this ends up in your possession. And we had a map in our practice area. We put pins in that people would write in from. And it was amazing how far that thing traveled. It got into the Soviet Union, and back then that was considered Western contraband. It got to
Yeah.
Israel. It got to Indonesia.
Wow.
It got to South Africa. It made it around the world.
Isn't that crazy?
And slow process, you know. Nowadays, a guy can post a video on YouTube and get around the world in 1 second.
Yeah.
But get those people to leave the house to come see you when you show up in their town is a
That
different story. So, you know, I wish we had the internet back then, but then yeah, but in the same story, he was like, I won't leave the house and
Yeah.
sit just in my underwear in bed.
I'd much rather do it where you have all the people have to come out to see you, you know.
But yeah, things have changed since then. I see videos of some of these local groups that are at it now, and technology wise and talent wise, they're fantastic.
Oh, I know.
They blow the crap out of what we were doing back then. Just YouTube alone, I think, is up the ante of talent in this country or the world. So yeah, it was a different story, different era, just different time period.
Yeah, you had to sell your tapes
yeah.
at the shows.
And, there, or and through actually, magazines. When you and I and those first original, we weren't the original wave. We had Death Squad, the St. Paul band.
Yeah.
Kublai Khan.
Yeah.
It was actually the main core of that band is from Cottonwood, Minnesota, a little town outside of Marshall that the person I'm seeing lives in now. I asked people who kind of got a slight interest in metal. You ever heard of Kublai Khan? From this town. But in Power Mad and Impaler, that was the first wave. And like when I first moved to Twin Cities and started going out seeing bands at night, like you're saying, Slave Raider and Paragon, I remember they were good.
Yeah.
I remember half these bands' names. But then I saw Impaler in the entry. And thought to myself, God, I could do that. Because you're so used to going and seeing, you know, big 16,000 seat arena things, Led Zeppelin and The Who and Rush and things like that. And it's like, how do you get to that level? How do you even begin?
Yeah.
And then you see Impaler in a little tiny room, about twice the size of this one. And it's like, wow. Can be done. You know? And that spurred my interest in trying to do it. So I've always been a fan of music since I was a little kid. I think it might have started with the Monkees, you know, or the Beatles cartoon, you know, back then. A lot of my upbringing and getting into music, I had neighbor kids that lived a couple houses north of me that were always in the garage putting together a go-kart, a motorcycle, customizing a bike. And they'd have an old 8-track back there or a radio, and they'd always be blasted by Sabbath, what you call it, or Grand Funk, or what was happening at the time. And then they had dudes that lived a couple blocks the opposite direction, had a big AM radio antenna in the backyard. They're talking to people all over the world. One of them's now a CEO of some very successful software firm out in the Bay Area. nerdy guys, but they were into like Emerson, Lake and Palmer, and the Moody Blues. Floyd, Yes, and stuff like that. So between the two of them, I kind of got a musical education. And then also back then, there was a radio station in Little Rock, Arkansas, KAY. They're still in existence, but I think it's a Christian talk.
Okay.
And it used to be like 10 o'clock at night. They'd switch over to what they call Beaker Street. And the name Beaker Street is basically LSD is made in a beaker.
Oh, it got its name. But, yeah, you tune that in while the rest of the world is playing Paul Anka and the Beach Boys and whatever else pop music was at the time, Archies or whatever. They're playing Led Zeppelin. They're playing Deep Purple. They're playing Nazareth, early stuff like that, UFO. And so between that radio station and these two neighbor guys, that's how I got my baptism and hard music, you know.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. Well, there was. I mean, when you look back to the stuff, you know, like Grand Funk and Steppenwolf and Deep Purple and that, and Sabbath, of course. I mean, I remember when I first heard Tony Iommi's guitar, I was like, "What is this? This is amazing!" Noise that's that beginning of Sweet Leaf. I was just like, what is this?
Oh, God.
I was into Kiss and Judas Priest and stuff like that. And then all of a sudden I heard Black Sabbath. And
I must have been 11 or 12 years old. And then I heard a radio advertisement. I didn't know it at the time. But remember the song DOA by Blood Rock? It was very morbid. Morticia did a cover of it. It's about a plane wreck. Something in the air. And okay. It's very morbid, very morose. And it was a brief hit on AM radio, like 72, 73. And then there are too many church groups and school groups complaining. It got pulled off the air in many, many markets. But the song still exists, and it's kind of creepy and eerie. Actually, Joe Perry, I remember reading in an interview, took that main riff and played it backwards, and that's the riff of Dream On.
Oh, really?
And when you listen to him, yeah, it does kind of sound familiar. But I heard that, and it was an advertisement for Black Sabbath in the opening act. Blood Rock were playing at the Minneapolis Armory. I've since found the ad somewhere online somewhere, yeah. But I heard that, and I thought that's the name of the band, Black Sabbath. The guys, okay. So next time I was out buying records, I picked up Paranoid.
Oh yeah.
Thinking that was the song that, you know, the DOA shit, which freaked me out. It freaked a lot of people out. They lost sleep, had bad dreams over it. It's pretty tame in today's standards compared to cattle decapitation or cannibal corpse. But yeah. You know, at that time, that was a pretty shocking song. And so then I come home with this record and play it, and well, that song wasn't on there, but the No, it was the first Black Sabbath record I bought, yeah.
Oh, okay.
But the song N.I.B. Oh, yeah. You know, okay. Nativity yep. in Black, that freaked the fuck out of me. Plus the title track, Black Sabbath. I mean, it says, wow, you know, here's this Sunday school going kid from the middle of nowhere, East Dakota, hearing this stuff for the first time. kind of changed my life in a way. Yeah, I must have been 10th grade. I was a huge fan of Blue Oyster Cult.
Yeah.
And had the old battle vest before they're even called battle vest. You know, Levi's denim with the arms torn off.
Oh, yeah.
And with magic markers and white paint, I made the first album cover of Blue Oyster Cult with the logo big and the big Blue Oyster Cult sign in the center. And I got into trouble at school, skipping classes, getting caught smoking dope in a bathroom. It's just stupid stuff teenagers do.
Yep.
And I talked to a school psychologist. And that was one of the questions they asked me. What's this Blue Oyster Cult? They thought I was in some goat sacrifice or weird shit. And it's like, no, dude, they're a band. They got laser lights and big Godzillas that shoot smoke. And I thought that was kind of humorous. They asked me, what's this cult you're involved in? I said, it's a bunch of nothing. But
no, where was it? Where
but,
was
you know, 1976 East Dakota, that was, yeah. You know, unheard of. You know?
Were you like the only metal guy in your town then?
Oh, I had people I grew up with that were into this, you know, at the time, whatever was happening, UFO, Black Sabbath, Deep Purple, whatever. But
yeah.
There's very few people that speak the language out there. I worked with a guy that I noticed he had an Iced Earth tattoo when I first started. I said, oh, you're into metal? Yeah, yeah, yeah. So we began talking. We're good friends still. But there's not many people that, like I say, speak the language.
Yeah, or even, I have trouble with it. It's like a second language for me, and I've been in it for 30 years.
And they'll tell me stuff like they're trying to impress me. Yeah, we're going to see 3 Days Grace. Knock yourself out. Yeah, fuck. I'd rather go deaf. I'd rather,
Yeah, it is different.
And I found myself traveling around Europe this summer after I'd gotten divorced, and I was in Belgium, and I kept on seeing posters for this festival, Grass Pop Festival. It still exists, one of the bigger ones in Europe. And they had Iron Maiden and Machine Head and Slayer and a lot of bands I was unfamiliar with, Anathema, which I'm glad I saw. But just, you know, it's a big metal festival, and I see posters all over the place for this, and it's like, I'd be interested in seeing that. So we bought tickets and went, and here I am in a Twins cap and cargo shorts. And, and there's guys dripping of metal, you know, just studs and leather. And I felt like a fool, but, you know, it was like almost walking back into a time capsule. Because in the United States, I call it jump rope. New metal was going on.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, when it had to go away. The hair metal had to die. It got replaced with all the Pearl Jams and Nirvanas and stuff, and I had no interest in it. And you could see the writing on the wall. it was one time you couldn't pay a coverage charge. You couldn't pay for a drink. And now it's like, yeah, you're old news.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah,
and
yeah.
It's like, and I wasn't in it for that. I gladly would have paid. But you can see the writing on the wall of metal is done. And what existed of metal went underground and came back out eviler and heavier and just a darker shade of black.
Yeah.
And so about 99 or so, like I said, I went to that festival in Belgium and it reignited my interest in metal. And 2 years later, I'm back together with Earl and we're playing metal again.
And that was God Awful?
That was God Awful, yeah. I couldn't use the name Disturbed, nor would I even want to.
Yeah.
We did get a cease and desist thing from Warner Brothers Records not to use that name anymore. And it's kind of funny because they had played the Target Center or XL or something that week. And from what we gather, somebody from their crew stopped in Earl's store. And Earl had some compilation CDs of bands from his label on the counter that were complimentary, free. So this guy grabbed one, and I think he grabbed it just because he read on the back Disturbed. And a week later, we got a fax from... Warner Brothers Records. Do not use this name. Market it. So... And it's like, that's, like I said, we spoke to a lawyer and who dealt in entertainment-type issues.
Yeah.
And he said, you could try, but, you know, they got enough money to bury and waste your time forever.
Yeah, yeah.
And it wasn't that big of a deal to us. It wasn't that big of a deal to me either. If they want that name, go ahead, use it. I don't care.
Yeah.
But
because at that point in time, you were kind of like...
It was over.
Yeah.
You know? And like I said, the name sounded very 1984. Earl, you know, the band prior to that was called Deranged. And we actually kind of worked a few of the Deranged songs at the very beginning and continued to play them. And so then we decided we got changed. We can't use Deranged any longer. So I was looking through a thesaurus for another word for insanity or madness. And came up with Disturbed, so, and that's what we ended up using. This guy, the guy on the CD, or our mascot and all our backdrops and stuff. Both Earl and I were into old horror films. And that's Lon Chaney, silent film actor from way back in the day.
Yeah.
Speaking of that festival in Europe, in Belgium, I was walking through a sea of people in this big circus tent, you know. They had a number of big tents with stage set up in them. And it was raining, and there's mud up to your ankle. So just to avoid the rain and not get saturated, was walking in one of these tents. And walking through a sea of people all dressed in black with pins and buttons and studs and chains and crap all over them. I noticed this neon green pin on this guy's lapel of his motorcycle jacket, and as I got closer, it's like, my God, that's a disturbed pin. And first thing I ask him, do you speak English? And he goes, yeah. And I said, where did you get this pin? And he goes, I got it in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, United States. And I says, wow. And I go, that's my old band, and one of our band members must have given this to you. Could have been. Yeah. He didn't seem too excited or impressed or whatever. I was like ecstatic. I'm halfway across the world and I run into my old logo, you know? Exactly. He also had on a Dungeon t-shirt.
Oh, really?
Which was a band from Twin Cities. I believe the singer went off to do something with Accept at one time.
Oh, really?
Yeah. So that was a double local hitter for me. You know, you've seen that and that. And it's like, I was all excited, man, but he didn't seem like whatever, you know, some dork from America in a Twins cap.
That's not him.
Still a dork from America with a Twins cap. No, I'm still a
dork. You're like dork from America. Twins had cargo shorts. Yep, that's what we're doing.
Nothing has changed. Hair got a little grayer. Heart don't beat as strong as it once did, but yeah.
So wow. Yeah, I remember I think when I ran into you at the mall, you had been just gotten back from that.
Could have been, tour. Yeah. It was about 25 years.
You were saying, like, there's all these tents, you go into these tents, they have all these dark bands and all everybody's wearing metal and everything.
Yeah.
Like that. It was like, wow, that was pretty cool. Because I do remember you telling
me. I didn't plan ahead of time for that one.
Yeah. You didn't have your leather pants or anything.
That was another thing we did intentionally with God Awful was the leather pants and the studs and the kick-ass boots and whatever. Because everyone else was wearing jeans that were 40 times too big for them.
Oh, that
and
time,
jumper open with a backwards cap on. So it's like, we're going to go for the total, what these people consider dorky, old-fashioned metal look, you know? Yeah. It, just to set ourselves apart.
Yeah.
And God Awful also kind of had the benefit of past reputation.
Yeah.
So we skipped the Fernandos. We skipped a lot of the places and went directly to main stage. Went directly to, I think our first show was The Quest. Then it was Milwaukee Metal Fest. And then it was First Avenue. And so we bypassed all the bullshit. We didn't have to play Wednesday nights at wherever, you know.
Ryan and, Speed Metal Mondays.
And a lot of these newer bands in town is like, who are these old fuckers? You know, they're getting these good gigs right away. And it's like, well, we were doing this quite a long time ago. So
yeah.
So yeah, in a way, you know, if we didn't have that past reputation, it would have been a real hard road to try to go up. So
yeah. Yeah, well, I mean, Earl had his record store at that time.
Yeah, he knew he was on his way out, you know. He knew he was dying when that band first got together.
Oh, he did.
And I think he wanted one last hurrah, you know.
Okay.
Take the bull by the horns and live life to its fullest, you know.
Yeah,
Then we had the rhythm section with the young guys, you know. And Andy always, you know, it's like, God, my first gig was The Quest, and second gig was Milwaukee Metal Fest, a big arena, you know. And it's like,
Yeah, Pierce was talking when I had Pierce over.
Yeah.
He was talking about the Milwaukee Metal Fest and how you guys brought him out to the Milwaukee Metal Fest. Mm-hmm. And he's like, we played it like 8 in the morning.
I was telling a cousin of mine the other day that we played Milwaukee once. It was one day, one stage, and I think we played at 10:30 in the morning. And I think Rick and Pierce's band played like at 8. I think they're one of the first few bands on stage, 8 or 8:30 or some ungodly time. And there were still 700-800 people in the room.
That's crazy.
You know? Yeah. I think the biggest crowd we ever played in front of was in Milwaukee. And that was like 90. And I think we were the last of the regional blip on the radar bands, you know? And then after us was your Cannibal Corpses, your Demolition Hammers, your Deicides. So we were the last of the unsigned nobodies. And at that time, we did have some record label interest looking at us.
Mm-hmm.
But by the time it came to be, we'd lost the interest. You could see the writing on the wall, Nirvana, Pearl Jam, that Smashing Pumpkin wave had already.
Yeah.
And we were out of business.
Yeah.
I was the first person to exit out.
Oh, were you?
Yeah. I just happened that we practiced at a house I was renting. And Nick Miller, the drummer of Disturbed at the time, he and I were living in a house in 32nd Lindale. He might have been to parties there.
Yeah.
We used to pay the rent by getting a keg of beer. The place smelled like an ashtray and an old keg. And anyway, they were practicing in the basement, and they were writing some new material. So I'm sitting upstairs listening to them through the floor, and I called it greasy rope music. There's nothing to grab a hold of. It's very technical, very scattered, very chaotic. And when it first came about, it was traditional Bay Area American thrash metal.
Yeah.
And now it's turned to this monster I didn't even recognize.
Yeah.
And then butting of heads about ideas of things. Blake and I love the guy to death.
Yep.
Blake who played bass for us towards the end of that era.
Mm-hmm.
I was getting a thing set up in Duluth at some club. I can't remember the name of the place, but it was the rock club of the time. Up there, Slave Raider had played it, and Successful Regime had played it and was successful up there. And a guy was up in that area, was negotiating to get us up there to play. And then Blake shows up to rehearsal one day and said, yeah, I got us a gig in Duluth. Oh, yeah, what's that? always had some hole in a wall for free beer on a Thursday night, opening up for the Two Cools or whoever the fuck they were. And it's like, nah, I didn't work this hard to play a Wednesday night opening up for some flannel shirt band. No, ain't gonna happen. And yeah, we butted a little bit of heads, but to this day, we're still. I just heard from a few months, not even a month ago, he called me out of the blue. You know, just. Yeah. Well, I don't know if I'm still alive and how things are going. You know,
he's still playing though, right? Because I remember he wasn't.
He is. Him and Mike and is a former roadie of ours, Troy Thomas, were in a band called Blackbird Bridge.
Okay.
And I asked Blake, "What become of that?" He really had no answer. I haven't spoke to Troy or Mike since that's fallen apart either. So what I've heard, it was good stuff. It was really good stuff. Now Blake is involved in a two-piece band with a guy that I think he's from Minnesota, but he's living in Hawaii now. So it's kind of a long commute. But nowadays, electronics, you can do things online together. But I think they're called Adrena. I think that's how it's pronounced. But,
oh, okay.
So, yeah, everybody, besides Earl, who's no longer with us, I think everybody's still involved in music except for me. I'm still a fan, but I don't participate. Yep. I got no desire. I got asked to, there's some local guys out where I live that were starting up a band. And I went to listen to them rehearse, and it was okay. You know, there's the basic, the right idea. Yep. And, But I had a health issue at the time also, old enough to be these guys' grandfather.
Yeah.
And plus I just had no, I didn't want to start from scratch. I didn't have time to hold their hand and walk them through the process.
Yeah.
Now they're actually doing good for themselves. I've given them a few, check this person out, friend this person, tell them I sent you. What few people I know that are still in the business. And they're doing something, they're called Slag. And they're doing shows around, you know, all over the place, anywhere they can go. Moorhead, Bemidji, Mankato, Twin Cities. So they're getting out there. They're, you know, they get in and living out where we do, everything's 2 hours away.
Yeah.
You know. But they asked me if I'd like to come do it, and I went to a few rehearsals and listened, and then I had something go haywire with me, and it's just like, I'm sorry, guys. You're gonna find someone your own age. You know, if you have any questions or need any help, get a hold of me. But they've done a lot of it on their own, which I'm proud of them. You know,
that's great.
Granted, it's easier to do nowadays, electronics and the internet and whatnot. But if I had any help or any, I can turn them on to anyone that can help them out. You know, great. Yeah. You know, I'm happy to see it still exists. You know, metal in it, you know.
And now are they metal?
They're like that party metal. You know, like Belushi Speedball, Municipal Waste, Vomit Metal. You know? it's fun. It's good fun, dumb. Yeah.
All right.
The equivalent to Crumbsuckers or DRI.
All right. See how I kind of lost the metal language there for a second on a couple of them?
I still pay attention to the new stuff.
I don't. I try, but it's hard because it takes
Too much of it for one. The jump rope, the new metal thing left its mark and it's now its own animal. I really don't follow much of it. I know people that are in bands that still do it, and you know, I admire them for that, and you know, wish them the best, but it was never my cup of tea.
Yeah.
Yeah,
I still think that dinosaur. Injustice for All is a new album, so. I remember when Injustice for All came out.
That's about the time I gave up on the band. I heard that, and also by that time, he had Obituary and Sepultura and things like that. And it was like, that sounded like a fart in the wind compared to.
Yeah.
And then, you know, in my opinion, Metallica's spirit died with Cliff Burton.
Yeah.
It was never the same band after that.
Yeah.
In 1986, 87, they were my favorite band in the world. God, they kicked butt. God, they were so fucking good.
Did you go down to the IO Jam and see them?
Yes, I did. Yeah.
What was it, Nugent and Dokken?
Yeah.
Armored Saint?
Smoke a bowl with Cliff Burton up in the last rows of the place. And, you know, and they weren't rock stars. They weren't well known then.
No. They were opening.
And they were wearing the clothes that they slept in the night before. Yeah. They looked like the guy that drove the truck and set up the PA. You know, and I had seen them First Avenue a year prior and just a few nights earlier at the Orpheum. And so I recognized him. You know, I ran into him and see a people from Iowa and got into Cliff Burton and said, "Hey, man, you guys kick ass. You're one of my favorite bands." "Oh, cool." He goes, "You got any weed?" "Yeah, we do." So we went up in the nosebleed area in the corner of the stage, and, you know, he was appreciative that we smoked him up. And, yeah, I should have gotten an autograph.
Yeah.
You know.
That's all right. The experience is
a couple months later, I found out the man died. So.
Yeah, it was. It was
September of 86, I believe. Yeah.
Was it September or was it November?
I don't remember. It was in the fall, yeah.
Yeah, in the fall. But that the Iowa Jam was in July or June.
Yeah,
or
June, I believe, Memorial Day weekend.
Yep.
I went to a number of those things back in the day.
Yeah.
I remember seeing UFO down there. And,
it was Bon Jovi and Cinderella, and I was disappointed because the Suburbs were supposed to play, and they canceled out because it was that whole Bon Jovi.
I seen Aerosmith and Ted Nugent down there.
But, yeah, that was on the same one. I actually found the article online not too long ago where it was, because I was like, God, was Cliff in the band when I saw Metallica? Because I didn't know.
Iowa Motor Speedway.
Yeah, I remember we camped there. I remember we just up all night long, you know? Mm-hmm. And then, but yeah, it was Metallica, Armored Saint, Dokken, Ted Nugent, and Aerosmith.
Yeah.
Can you imagine going to that concert today?
Oh, it would cost you a fortune for one.
Oh, my God. I think it was probably $13 to go.
I usually hit one festival a year.
Do you?
Yeah. It's been Milwaukee the last couple of years. It's close.
Yeah.
But, you know, 10 years ago or so, I drove up to Montreal, Canada to heavy MTL and seen Typo Negative.
Oh, nice.
Just a ton of shit. It was great. It was almost like being in Europe because everyone's speaking French.
Yeah.
But been to Vegas for festivals. Went to one out in the Bay Area a number of years back, seen Autopsy and Warbringer. And God, 1 year bleeds into the next. And it's like,
yeah.
You remember the event. You can't remember half the bands you've seen. But.
Oh, yeah. Exactly. Well, I got confused. You remember Ozzy's tour here with Motley Crue?
Yeah, it was a blizzard. It was cold as hell.
Yeah. Well, the thing is that in my head, and this is the Mandela effect, I thought Randy Rhoads was the guitar player at that time, but it was Jakey Lee.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. And so somebody called me out on that because I had mentioned that. I was like, yeah, I think I saw Randy Rhoads play with Ozzy, but he didn't play on that tour. It was Jakey Lee at that time.
Yeah, I'd seen Randy Rhoads at the River Flat Jam down by the university. That must have been 80.
Really?
Yeah, and it was Motorhead who opened it up the show.
Oh, no kidding.
I remember Lemmy going, "You bloody ace, you got no respect," because no one was paying attention to him. And I think Lamont Cranston played. It was just like a fart in the wind compared to after Motorhead. And Ozzy Osbourne, and I think 38 Special headlined it, but I was out the door by that time. I had no interest in seeing that hillbilly shit. Although I did see 38 Special about 10, 15 years ago. They're good at what they do, and but at that time I had no desire to sit through that.
So what kind of brought you guys to start playing at First Avenue? How did First Avenue come into the was it because other bands had kind of paved the way, or were, because to me that first Avenue show that we did together was in the entry was kind of like, this is the birthday of metal.
That's kind of that's kind of the preschool to the main campus. Kissing butt, and also drawing people. You had to prove to, you know, McCullum had a good eye for new talent. You know, in First Avenue covered everything, you know, techno dance music to alternative to hardcore to metal.
Yeah.
And everything in between. So, you know, the club wasn't 24/7 metal or punk or whatever the case might be. It was a variety of everything. And just paying our dues, selling the place out the entry, I mean.
Yeah.
We had played it with the first version of Disturbed a number of times, maybe three times. They weren't really well attended. There's local acts and stuff. I think what pushed us over the edge is we opened up for Dark Angel and Death. And some problem between Death and Dark Angel about who should headline and whatnot caused Death to bail and leave the tour. And so we got notice that we were supposed to go on like at doors open at 4, you're on at 5:02.
Yeah.
Or 4:02 or whatever. Yeah. And so the doors open and there's like a 45-minute lag. So the room was actually full. And then the lights, you know, the lights went out and most people showed up, you know, by that time thinking Death is the next band up there. So the curtain comes up and it's us. And we got a good reception. And people dug it. It was metal. I mean, that's most of the people in the crowd are metal fans. But that was a pretty important day in our history. Because we filled the room up once in the entry, and then a couple months later got to open up for Dark Angel, and the room was fairly packed. It wasn't sold out, but it was, you know, for a Wednesday afternoon in middle of nowhere. Yeah, we did okay. And then a lot of and this doesn't happen as much anymore, but a lot of our in town here playing was opening up for major acts.
Yeah.
You know, Overkill or Flotsam Jetsam or whatever the case might be.
Because, Pantera.
Pantera, yeah. We opened up for them twice. At the first time, you guys opened up for them also at...
At the entry.
Yeah. We opened up for them at Ryan's, and there was probably 40 people in the room.
That's crazy.
And then a year later, we got to open up for them again at the Mirage, and the place was sold out. Probably like 3,200 people or something. How many, I don't know how many people were, fire capacity was there, but
yeah,
it was a lot of damn people. Yeah. We got 86 that night. We were told we're never going to play there again.
Oh, yeah.
And why? Because you started a riot. It's like Whoopi John Wilfart could have got up there with an accordion. Those kids came to peel the carpet off the floor and dive off tables. You know, so it didn't matter who opened. They were going to go nuts that day.
Yeah.
And I think after, you know, the minor fart in the wind that we were compared to Pantera, how that room blew up. Yeah, so for a time period, we were not allowed back in there again. Yeah, and, prior to us playing there, there really wasn't too much extreme metal. I think I seen Armored Saint there, Sabotage there or something. Yeah. But towards the end of that building's career, that club's career, and Decker was booking bands in there, you'd get Malevolent Creation, you'd get Deicide, you'd get Obituary.
Oh, yeah. It's just so crazy to see that. It's like
night and day difference.
An evening with David Lee Roth. Deicide type of negative.
Yeah. It was a total different crowd, total different genre. Yeah, it started out as a glam club. Mm-hmm. Good place to go pick up girls in miniskirts and high heels, but if you're into heavy music, it wasn't this place, you know. But it was kind of strange how tables turned. And
now you knew Decker for a really long time, didn't you?
I met Decker, and I think he was 17.
Yeah.
And he was he was in the business of purchasing tickets. This is before Ticketmaster and all these ticket selling services nowadays.
Yeah.
And he was at the Met Center paying people to stand in line to get as many as they'll allow you to buy tickets for Iron Maiden. This must have been like the Peace of Mind tour or something like that, or Power Slave, or talking about ancient history. And I ran into Decker and talked with him and told him about this band and our band, Earl and I's band.
Yeah.
And he shows up at a gig, I think Fernando's actually. Decker would show up at gigs all over the place, Missouri, Indiana, wherever, you know, all of a sudden Decker shows up, you know. And he used to credit me for creating that monster of him, you know, in a way, because I held his hand and explained things to him. Decker was actually a very smart, sensitive person, but he didn't show it in public much because he had to play this role of being this evil ogre, you know. Yeah. But he actually was a very thoughtful, sensitive person. We had many, many good conversations late at night about things. Then there was moments where he was the evil ogre. And, you know, he's saved me from getting my ass beat and then threatened to beat my ass. You know, do my band a favor, book us on something, and then deny us something and then rub it in our nose. And Decker used to kind of pit different bands against each other. Like, I've known Rick Tyler from the Game Hens since I moved to this city. And we got along great. And then I think just to spur competition,
mm-hmm,
and competitiveness, in which it's not a competitive sport, but no. He started agitating them about us and vice versa. And then finally one day, me and Rick just like, what's Decker trying to accomplish? You know? It's like, I've known you forever. I think your band's great. And it's like, yeah, vice versa. So he'd like to sit back and watch the fur fly. And I think it is also, he thought he was bolstering the strength of the metal community by causing animosity between. Yeah, interesting guy, really was. I do miss hearing from him, because like I said, he was an intelligent person, and you could have, yep, a good conversation with him. He'd talk about quantum physics or ancient, really, world history,
really,
or spirituality, and things you'd never think would come out of Decker's mouth, but they did.
Yeah.
He just wasn't about puss blood pentagrams and whatnot, you know. I first heard that demo tape, I thought that was the best damn name I ever heard. Puss blood pentagram. Oh, fucking wonderful. That was a good one, wasn't it? It's very Decker. God, it's such like, bad taste. It's so like, juvenile. It's so...
I don't think people today would have a hard time understanding what he was doing. But for me, it was freaking hilarious.
No, it was
wonderful.
Yeah. It was
absolutely wonderful when he did the anal black. Because he had such a progression. Because he started out being the big guy in the pit. You just stand, mm-hmm, in the middle of the pit.
Yeah.
And then moved on to, what did he first start doing? Was he putting together his own shows, like the Avalon or something like that? Did he do the Avalon? I think he did do the Avalon.
He may
and Varsity
have.
Theater and stuff like,
yeah,
that.
Yeah, remember he broke the Varsity, yeah.
Yeah, and so he did that, and then he was booking for the Mirage, and then he took over Station 4.
Well, he was doing a lot of shows at First Avenue, too, for a while.
Yeah.
Those metal massacres where,
yep,
it was the first incidents of, it wasn't pay to play, but you'd hand out flyers with your name circled on it. Or,
yep, whatever. I got one of those that, yeah, I can put up right now, and it's, yeah, got you guys, us, Game Hens right there.
Yeah.
And those were all main stage, too.
Yeah. Well, they would have bands in the other little room, too. Some, yeah, bands preferred playing in that little room.
I love that. That felt like home.
I considered First Avenue our home court. That was, yep, home ice. That,
yeah. You recently had some health stuff. And I know that a lot of people were curious about how you were doing and all that kind of stuff.
Since 45, I've had a lot of health stuff. Like between 40 and 60, it's like everything just fell apart. But, yeah, I lived through a heart attack a year and a half ago. I was actually clinically dead for 8 minutes. People always ask, did you see lights? Did you see great grandmothers come running out of the clouds after you? And didn't see a damn thing. I'd lost a week of my life. I was just totally unaware of what happened. And I wake up in a hospital room with tubes coming up my nose and my torso and monitors hooked to me. And I don't have enough energy to blow my nose, you know? And they told me I survived a heart attack. And at that moment, thinking, God, if this is the way the rest of life's going to be, you know, weak in a hospital bed and shitting in a pan and getting washed by nurses, which ain't that bad. But I'd rather not be around. But then, like I was saying, each week got better. Each month is better than the last. It took about half a year to even feel semi-normal. And when I look back now, when I thought I was back, you know, fully, yeah, functioning again, it's like last month this month is better than the last. It's just like as time goes on, my heart is damaged. It's lucky to be beating.
Yeah.
But I'll live through it. Been through worse. I've been in diabetic comas before. I've survived cancer. And, you know, just...
It's a lot. I know, because I know that I was real curious, you know, and you don't want to... I didn't want to be like, hey, Jimmy, just wonder how you're doing.
Doing fine.
When you pulled up, I'm like, yep, he's doing great. That's awesome. That's awesome.
Yeah, I'm... Yeah, still functioning.
Still going to metal shows.
Half a step, yeah.
What was your most recent metal show you went to?
Milwaukee.
The Metalfest.
Yeah.
Metalfest.
Prior to that
kind of like seemed like second home? Like,
We played there quite often.
Yeah, it's on First Avenue's first home base.
It's the closest big town besides here, you know, so.
Yeah.
Prior to that, I think it was, I don't go as often. And also, winter time, nothing happens. Summer and winter, not much happens in the United States. It's all in Europe.
Okay.
You know, and fall and metal, fall and spring are metal season. So I think the last show I went to prior to that was like Dying Fetus back in December or November or something like that.
Oh, okay.
So I don't, you know, and I'll see a band comes to town and say, oh, God, that'd be great. But I've seen them 24 times.
Yeah.
And the first time you saw him was $6. Now it's $80. You know, yeah. And it's like, yeah.
Did you go to Judas Priest recently at the Armory?
No, I saw him in Mankato about 2 years ago with Queensryche. They were.
Oh, okay. Queensryche. Was that Jeff Tate singing for him?
No, no. It's that new guy. But they were actually very, very impressive.
Oh, that's
very
cool.
Very good.
I saw Jeff Tate on his own.
Yeah, no, yeah.
It was the Jeff Tate experience. It was like an evening with Jeff Tate.
Oh.
It was nothing like Queensryche.
Last time I'd seen Queensryche with him as a vocalist, it was a pretty pathetic display. Was, yeah.
Because, yeah, they opened up for Metallica on Justice for All tour.
Yeah,
they
I remember one, that.
And the Cult did the first time they came through.
And they brought the male strippers out there. Yeah. Yeah, I still go to metal shows. Like, you know, a bunch of them have popped up there for the fall now that, because it's, you know, like I said, fall is metal season in the United States. I see them and it's like, God, I'd like to go to that. But then it's like, I've seen that band so many times.
Yeah.
And it's, you know, 10 times what it used to cost.
Yeah.
For what it cost to buy one beer and to park and to get in the door is now the service fee from Ticketmaster. You know, it's just obnoxious. So.
They're trying to combat that a little bit now, though, so hopefully something will come out of that.
Yeah. And plus, metal kind of knows that their fan base is kind of low budget. And
Cause,
they're
I
not
mean,
too greedy about it.
When but. We used to play at like the entry, when we did those entry shows, it was like $7 a head. And at that time, that was pretty
chunk
high
change.
Cover.
Yeah,
for,
yeah.
Especially for a bunch of 15-year-old kids on a
now
Sunday night.
Now you can't
night.
Even park your car for that.
I know, right? Yeah,
it's changed a lot.
Do you remember the Rochester show that we did?
The Armory? Yeah, that was great. You guys had a car accident on the way down there,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, Kenny Olsen was driving his truck.
Yeah.
And smashed into us in the car in front of him, and then we hit a nun from Richfield.
I believe,
in a Yugo.
I believe that's the night I met my ex-wife. I don't recall, but she says that's how we met.
Okay. That was a big deal. Broadway Records, that was...
Yeah, it was at the Armory. It was pretty well attended, too. I got a video of that somewhere at home.
Yeah, if you can find that, that'd be great.
Yeah, I'll have
to
get you a shot of that.
And that's where we met Sean Jensen.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, Sean. Actually, the very, very last god-awful performance, after we did that Missing Man formation thing with 13 members or whatever it was, the core of us decided to play a few shows here and there. We opened up for Warbringer. We opened up for Ross the Boss. We did a show with We Are Legion and Impaler up in St. Cloud. Did about a half a dozen shows that year afterward. It couldn't go on forever. Other people had other projects going on. You can't beat a dead horse forever.
Yeah.
And I was getting up in ages. I was 50, I believe, at the time. And I thought that's well, way overdue to retire. But then there's guys now that are mid-50s still going at it. But
the Stones are at it right now.
Yeah, but they're getting paid. They're traveling first class and getting catered food. You know, we're driving around in old vans with dirty laundry and guitar cabinets. And so, yeah, people always bring that up. Yeah, the Stones are still doing it. Iron Maiden's still doing it. Yeah, but they're getting paid. Crying out loud, you know. Yeah. Never was in it for money.
No.
Yeah. It costed money, if anything. But,
yeah. It was. I think that's why we all did so, had such a good time with it, because it wasn't about that, you know?
Yeah. Well, it was new also at the time.
Yeah.
You know, it was...
There wasn't, I mean, this scene was created. I mean, essentially, you guys were the torchbearers for the scene.
Well, like I said, there was Kublai Khan, there was Impaler, there was Power Mad prior to us. But so we're kind of the second wave. Yeah. But, and then all of a sudden, you didn't hear about Power Mad anymore. I don't know what happened to him. Just kind of fell off the map. And then Impaler, things just went different for them, became Daddy Raw for a bit. Kublai Khan split up, went away, ended up we were the last man standing
at
that time. Other bands came after us. I was glad to see it happen because, you know.
It was fun.
And sometimes to be in the top of the shit pile, it ain't exactly as, you know, not what it's cracked up to be. Unfortunately, someone's got to be it, and we were it for 3-4 years back in early 90s. But takes a lot of time, a lot of effort, a lot of work,
a lot of
learning from mistakes, a lot of miles, a lot of wearing out tires, and
it's
an expensive hobby. Can be. Yeah.
That was still one of the greatest times of my life.
Mine too. Yeah. I look back on it fondly.
Yeah. So you guys had... So you were not in Deranged. I always thought you were in
Deranged. No, a guy named Andy was a singer for that. Andy, God, we're talking ancient history. I'm lucky to remember his first name.
Isn't it amazing when you can all of a sudden remember these things? It's like, why do I remember this?
Yeah.
But then, I'll have somebody standing right in front of me, and I'm like,
I have no idea who you are. I haven't seen or heard about anybody from that band in forever. Early on, they still existed and were still around town. I was always cool with everybody in the band. They might not have been with me because I touched their microphone or something, or stole their Earl away from them, or that wasn't the case. But
I guess you and Earl went pretty much the whole time.
Until we were talking about Jensen a minute ago.
Sean Jensen.
And I never did finish that. He played the very last god-awful... every last time I set foot on stage, except for one time at the Spring Street or a Club Underground, I did one song with Peace of Mind. Which one member still... Sloan still lives in Minnesota. Mike is in Phoenix, I believe. And his brother, Matt, is... Dallas, I believe.
Okay.
Yeah, and they flew up here. It was around Christmas time, and did like 6 songs.
Yeah.
And asked me if I'd come up and do a Celtic Frost cover. So I did. That was the very last time I set foot on stage.
Yeah.
Very brief, 3 minutes is over with. It was fun to hear people cheer. Yeah. I mean, that's your pay is cheer.
Yeah.
people diving off stages and elbows and fists in the air. And that's your pay, you know.
Yeah.
But Earl was always on my left side.
Yeah.
Every time I stepped foot on stage, except for the very last time Sean Jensen did. And I called Michael, left a message, never got back to me. And it's like, okay, whatever, you're not interested in doing this. So I asked Sean, you want to step in and do Earl's part? Yeah, I'll do it. He was playing with Grand Demise of Civilization at the time. Okay, no. We'll be right back. living in Wisconsin and commuting up to rehearse and whatnot.
Wow.
And I don't know where Sean is now. I think he's down in Rochester area again from last I heard, but okay. No idea. I haven't spoken to him in quite a while. But that was the only time I got up on stage that Earl wasn't there.
Oh, really? Yeah. That was it, huh?
Well, no, Mike was there too. Yeah, like I say in these half a dozen shows we did after the Missing Man formation thing, which was Missing Man was a benefit for the cancer fund of some sort, and everybody that played with Earl back in the day, at least for God Awful and Disturbed. So,
yep.
I got on the phone. I got a hold of everybody. One or two people I was unable to get a hold of, but everyone else said they'd gladly do it, and they came up here from Nebraska and northern Minnesota and wherever else they were residing from and got together for a week and rehearsed, and we beat that old music, you know, one more time. I was honored to be asked to do it. Actually, when Nancy called me, Earl's wife or widow, and says, we've set up a show for Cancer Fund at First Avenue. Do you think you can get a handful of guys together to assemble a band and do some of that old material? And I think I got 9 people, 10 people to agree to do it. And a couple people just couldn't because of distance and life and health issues or whatever. Yeah. But I actually almost felt a tear develop in the corner of my eye. I got to get to play that room one more time.
Yeah.
You know, yeah. Never thought I'd see the day that would happen, but it did. Very momentful time in my life. Very honored to do it. Very happy to. It's happy to be remembered.
Yeah.
I don't like patting my own back or tooting my own horn, but
yeah.
From time to time I'll get well, like at Metalfest last month or whatever it was. Jamie Josta, the guy from Hatebreed, has bought the rights to the name, and is the promoter, the money and the brains behind it all.
Okay.
And seen him the last day of it, and as I walked by and passing, I just said, and I, you know, being honored to shake your hand, dude, and I'm really happy to see that you've resurrected this and brought it back to life again. And he goes, well, thanks for coming. And I said, where'd you come from? Minnesota. So yeah. Back in the day, my band played here 4 times. I've probably been here as a fan 6 times. And I'll probably make the trip again next year. And he goes, oh, what's the band you're in? And I go, I legally can't tell you. And he kind of looks confused, and they go, we were called Disturbed. He says, oh, I got 3 of your demo tapes. They go, well, that's 2 more than I got. I don't even know what the other 2 are. And and talked with him briefly and said, I remember seeing you guys here like 1991 or something like that. I said, oh, cool, thanks, you know. Yeah. So someone of his position nowadays and the new generation even remembering us, it's just kind of nice to get remembered. And I had a email a year or 2 back. Some kid out in Spokane, Washington, says, he just looked at names on there and did a Google search or whatever, and yeah. Got a hold of me and said, were you the singer of Disturbed? And I go, yes, I was. And he says, oh, my dad grew up in the Twin Cities, and he gave me a big box of tapes, and yours was one of them. And he saw it. And it's like, wow, that's cool. And he had some fanzine that he was doing, and he wanted to do an interview of me. And so we got on the phone one night, and he asked me a bunch of dopey questions, and I answered them. And
yeah.
But yeah, it's nice to get remembered. Yeah. Milwaukee, keep bringing that up because that's the last thing I went to. And it's almost like a class reunion for me because yeah. There's people I haven't seen in 25, 30 years that I never see unless I go there.
Yeah.
Because that's kind of mecca of metal. It's like, mm-hmm. You know, if you live in Indiana or Iowa or Wisconsin, you're there, you know, yeah. And you don't ever see these people unless you go to it. And ran into a lot of people. And like I said, I don't like patting my own back. I went with Josh Kellerman. And he's like, we start talking to some people and say, yeah, he played this thing 4 times and with Disturbed. And it's like, that was you? Oh, fuck, man, you were great. And it's like, I hate idol worship. I just don't, whatever, dude.
Not your thing, yeah.
No, I don't. And so it's nice to be remembered. It really is. Like I was telling you, the dude I ran across in Belgium that had that pin on, and he had a record and he had a demo of ours and remembered seeing us at one time. And it's just like, wow. You know, it's kind of amazing that people remember shit like that from so long ago. Yeah. It meant much and nothing to me at the time, but to them. Yeah. And then you'll run across people and say, dude, remember we smoked a joint in a parking lot in Detroit? And it's like, they remember it. I don't. And it's like, yeah, sure. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. I remember that. Yeah. Remember that time in Des Moines? No, but if you had a good time, I'm happy for you. But
yeah.
So yeah, it is cool to get remembered. It makes it all worthwhile.
Yeah.
Somebody dug it, and that's basically the reason I dug metal. So that's why we played it.
Yeah.
If someone else liked it, that was icing on the cake. So.
Yeah, I think that group, or you want to call them Phase Two of the Metal, in Minneapolis, they pretty much the majority of us really put our heart into everything. It's you know, it's like doing the best that we possibly could, preparing as much as we possibly could, trying to involve as many people as we could.
And it's kind of a learning curve, too, because you had no other blueprint to follow.
No.
You're kind of creating it as you went along.
Yep.
Were you? And Minneapolis was a punk and hardcore town. It wasn't a metal town.
No, yeah.
It's known for alternative music.
And that kind of stuff. And then Prince and that kind of stuff. And that's all First Avenue, too.
And like I was saying outside, there's been other guys that have gone on to major acts.
Mm-hmm.
Really no bands in their entirety. Power Mat is probably the one that got the closest at that. But Jimmy Mahurl. Played with Andrew W.K. Nick from God Awful played with Deeds of the Flesh and from Cataclysm in Montreal. He left Minnesota to move to Canada to play with Cataclysm for a number of years. So then, and that guy I asked if you went to school with that played at Nevermore for a while. So there's been guys from here that have gone on to do other things, but no band as a whole has ever took off and flown.
Yeah.
I mean, there have been a handful, but nobody to hit that upper echelon, you know.
Yeah, which is kind of good. I don't know if I could. I don't know if I would have lived through going through the upper echelon, to be perfectly honest.
Yeah,
I was a little bit nuts.
I'm almost glad we didn't get signed, because that meant I had to delay my maturity and prolong this childhood a little bit longer. And like I said, I got used to being fat, lazy, and suburban.
Yeah.
And the idea of getting in a van and driving to Dallas or fucking Cleveland doesn't appeal to me anymore, you know. So
I remember that another person that we haven't brought up yet is Eric Freitag.
Oh god, I love that guy. I haven't spoken to him.
Do you remember
in a while,
the Iowa Maiden call?
Oh yeah. The one that came from Iowa.
We opened up, and it was Shedford opened up, and then it was us, and then it was you guys, and it was our second time down there. And I think we had Ritual Agony on there or something like that, or Atomic Opera, one of those bands. Yeah. And I just remember ever since then that noise.
Atomic Opera had Jim Root, that was now in Slipknot.
Oh, really?
I was a member of that, yeah.
Oh, that's right, Slipknot's from down there, aren't they?
Yeah, actually, Slipknot. Well, Anal Blast started with two members of Slipknot. They're both deceased now, but the guy that wore the pig mask and played bass and the drummer were original members of Slipknot. I think there's 40 guys in all that have been in and out the door with them, but those were the first, the original. And Decker asked me if we could practice, because we had a PA and a practice spot in the house I was living in. And for some reason, it never happened, but if he could use our space to rehearse in, but...
But Freitag, he did hold the torch for a while.
Oh, Eric was wonderful.
Up in Duluth.
Yeah.
He hasn't shown his face on anything in a while. Have you talked to him? Or?
A telephone once a year about it's been recently. Yeah, he's still up in Duluth. He drives for UPS. He was in a number of bands, but living in Duluth, it's not too conducive for metal or live music in general.
Yeah.
Plus, he's getting up in the years. Eric's looking at 60 in a few years, I'd imagine.
He's perpetually 22.
Oh, yeah.
I'll never, you know what I mean?
Love that guy. Yeah, I always have. he's something else. Just, yeah. Eric was good. He was really good. I love Shred Fit. That was just a big kick in the fucking mouth. They were great. I wish they could have gotten better success than they did, but...
I think that they got hit by that flannel as well.
Yeah, they got
the damper from the flannel.
Yeah, that's right.
But weren't yeah, cool Kevin, their drummer, bought a bass for me online. Came over and he's like, "Hey, how you doing? We were talking, you know." And he's like, "I used to be in a band too, and I played with you." And I was, "What band were you?" I was in Shredfit. It's like,
"Yeah,
you're the drummer." I don't.
He was in a Christian metal band called Crimson Thorn for a while too. He's in some prog metal band now. I mean, I hear from him on Facebook occasionally.
Yeah, he's doing stuff. He's still playing and stuff. He's got a kid.
Doing well for himself. Very spiritual person.
Yep.
Kevin was something else at one time. Total 360 turnaround. Different guy now.
Yeah.
But, yeah.
Yep, yeah.
He's another person I haven't seen in 35 years, but... Jaquist that was in... Shred Fit. I have lost total contact with him. Him and I talked about doing a few things together, like when Disturbed first fell apart. Him and I and Jerry.
St. Martin?
And also, Jerry asked me to audition for another band he was in, a bunch of guys in St. Paul, Lance Schoenwalter and a couple other guys, and I just wasn't feeling it at the time, so politely bowed out.
Yeah, there was the cast of people that we had back then was great, because you'd go to, so Deckard get a house up in North Minneapolis.
Oh, those are wonderful.
Decide that he's going to have some bands play there. And luckily,
no one was killed at that location. God, that was a violent, nasty neighborhood.
Pierce was just telling me about the first time he played there, and they got attacked by gang members or something. Oh. The house did.
Yeah.
For having the metal out there. But I just remember that he'd take the top off the keg that said Black Label, and he'd throw a Miller Genuine Draft thing in the keg down. It was so good. I miss Decker. He was great.
Yeah, he really was. One of a kind.
I remember when he was, towards the end of it though, his, at Station 4, the shows were still great. I remember going and seeing some of his concerts and stuff like that he was putting on. And then what was it, the Swordsman or whatever took over for a while? Do you remember
that? Oh, yeah, Nathan, the Sword Lord.
Yeah.
Nathan Block, yeah. I don't think he's involved in it any longer. He's into motion pictures. He owns a theater, I know. I think he's trying to get into small film production of some sort. I honestly don't know. But
okay. Yeah, because he took the reins for a little while.
Yeah, he did. Yeah, I'm not sure who's doing it nowadays. I know Greg Shilton is involved with a lot of local bookings and stuff. And
yeah, like the only person that I
lose track of stuff, man.
Yeah, the only person that I know that's still, like, the only couple of people, Josh Kellerman.
Yeah.
Of course. Tom Croxton, you know. Terrace from Akron, he's playing with Rock Gods now.
Okay.
And then Chad and Kurt, they do their Fret Rattles thing.
Yeah.
They're kind of doing the same thing that they were doing after Animosity with that kind of heavy rock and roll-y type stuff.
Yeah.
And they're brothers. They'll be together forever.
Oh, yeah. No separating that. Yeah.
And then Impaler. Impaler's been doing it and going.
Oh, yeah. I've always loved Impaler.
Yeah. They do the Kiss Days at No Name Records.
Yeah.
Have you ever heard about that? Mm-hmm. On November 1st, like week in November, they'll just take the one side of the store and they'll set up a PA and they'll have everybody come and do like weird Kiss stuff. Oh, Impaler did a set of Kiss, and you know, some guys, two guys did Shandy.
And you mentioned Josh Kellerman, the very, very, very first show I ever did with Earl and Disturbed. Front and center row is Josh Kellerman and Joe Conrad. And they're about 15 years old, 14 years old at the time.
Yeah.
And it was some talent show bullshit Earl got us on at the Armory in Stillwater. And these two guys are front and center, and they're the only guys in metal attire. And we did not belong on that bill. I think we won second place. But when I see the video of that, I was so vulgar and we were so raw and green that shit had a police called on us. But yeah, that's the first time I met Josh, the very, very first
Yeah, he's still just the same guy, just doing it.
Yeah,
doing
he, nothing, doing a lot of last change. Put on a few more pounds and lost a little hair, brother. He's the same guy.
He's still singing.
Yeah.
You know? So you, how'd you feel about going in the studio again?
For what?
To sing.
Someone else's material, just a couple of lines, great. Do I want to do a full record of something that I wrote? No.
No, but I mean the whole studio experience. Oh, it's kind of exciting?
I hate it because it's too true. Like I was telling you earlier, I was doing Obituary before Obituary surfaced. And that's how you get the cadence of songs going, is just mumbling and growling over the top of it. And the studio's a scary place because it shows how awful you actually are. And I know there's a lot of technical tricks to doctor shit up and make it up and make it pretty and sound good. But I was never a fan of being in the studio. Live was my...
Yeah.
My forte.
I always just felt so bad every time I took it. It's like, is this what I really sound like?
Oh, I know. Gee, well, everyone else is so excited to get in there and lay their tracks down. I was like, oh, God, this dreadful day is coming.
It's like, here I go.
Proof, yeah.
So
proof, you have no talent. And I knew I had no talent. And someone advised me a long time back, your job is to be a cheerleader.
Yeah.
Not everyone can play drums or guitar, but everybody, most everybody, at least in America, can speak English or understand English. So you have to portray, you're the human element of the band they can relate to.
I gotcha.
So, and become entertaining. And watching Bill Lindsay, learned a lot from him.
Yeah.
Learned a lot from watching everybody. Just throughout time, you pick up things. I mean, you see the greats, Roger Daltrey, Freddie Mercury, Ronnie Van Zant. Not that I'm going to be playing anything similar to what they did, but just their showmanship.
Yep.
You borrow a little of this and a little of that. And
yep, the undefinable qualities that you can pick up from people.
Yeah, so you had to learn right off the bat. Well, you're not a good singer, but you could possibly be a good cheerleader, a front man.
Front man, yeah.
Yeah, and your job is the human element of the band, the speaking.
Yeah.
And everybody can speak and hopefully can hear. If you can't hear, what are you doing at a metal show anyway? But
that'd be the place to be if you couldn't hear at all. It'd be great.
I did know a guy that had very limited hearing, and he loved metal. He liked the vibration of it.
You get that double bass.
But he liked the hair swinging and so forth and all that. He thought that was great, but you really couldn't discern words or notes. But just the sonic vibration, the abuse of it.
I do miss being able to do that.
Yeah.
Just envelop something.
Nothing better to have the curtain go up and 400 horns fly up at you.
Exactly.
Elbows and knees and people upside down and flying through the air. That's your paycheck. No, right
that, there. That was amazing. That was amazing.
I remember the Heart of the Beast Theater.
Where was that?
Bloomington Lake. It was a big old, it used to be a porn movie theater.
The Avalon.
I think it was the Avalon at one time. Yes, and then it got changed to Heart of the Beast Theater. And Decker did a handful of shows down there.
Yeah, we played with Laz Rocket there.
Yeah, I remember that. Yeah.
And I think one of the guys from one of the Rochester bands was on that too.
Yeah.
I want to say Cole, maybe.
And then that was the early days of the Varsity before that place got cleaned up and polished and spit shined. And
yeah.
So there was a handful of big venues. There was the Mirage. Yeah, briefly. So there are some big venues in town, you know. So
yeah, well, and there was an audience to go see them too. I mean, pre-internet, it was.
We started getting asked by different clubs and different bands to be part of or headline or be an opening act for other than styles of metal, and I was adamant about sticking to our guns.
That's
and,
awesome.
We're not going to alienate our fans to a form of music they're probably not going to dig, and vice versa. I don't think these people are going to dig us either.
Oh, that's
so. It's kind of like staying true to your school.
Yeah, that's difficult for me now with the modern day is the logos. I can't
read half.
I can't read anything that these. Yeah. Bands, what band are you in? I'm in Hersnipiff.
Yeah. Have you heard the band from Columbus, Ohio, Sansusabog? No. I think that's how it's pronounced. Totally unlegible, totally unpronounceable, and they want it that way. And I think it's doing them. They're doing well because of it. And they got some really stupid titles of songs like Drag Behind a Fucking Truck. I mean, what a great. I'd seen them the year ago and I was just totally amazed. It's just dumb and heavy and immature, but it was great. Wonderful. Just, yeah. Reminded me a lot of myself back in the day.
What were they? What are they?
Sansusabog? Sanguisa? I don't.
They all have these pointy logos.
Sudafed Toboggan or something.
Looked like, you know, it looked like some kid that didn't have his ADHD medicine that day.
Yeah,
just decided to draw just something.
Grab a pile of sticks and throw them in a pile and take a picture of it. You got
there
logo.
You go. That's our name.
Yeah.
I think that a lot of that, though, comes from like the whole, you know, the Norwegian side. I think the logos could and stuff be. Like that comes from that Norwegian metal.
I've been a fan of thrash. I'm fond of a lot of death metal. The super technical stuff. It's a jerk-off contest. I'm really not too, you know, it's impressive to see. I very seldom buy discs anymore, but a lot of times you'd buy a disc and you'd listen to it and, huh, that's good, and you put it on the shelf and it's never listened to again. I heard that once before.
Yeah.
But then there's stuff like lately, the last Catatonia record, which is almost a year and a half old now, is like a weekly play for me. Because I discover something new in it. The production value on it's so rich and so good that you'll discover things new in there. Or in hindsight, after thinking about lyrics for a while, or you read about something else, and then that's what they're getting at. That's what they're talking about.
And what was that band you were saying?
Catatonia, which is basically, you've heard of Bloodbath?
Yeah.
Another Swedish supergroup, Dan Swano, and the bass player of... Singer is the bass player in Bloodbath. Singer Catatonia is, and the guitar player Catatonia, which is really stupid. I say stupid is good, it's very traditional death metal. I mean, they got a song called "Eaten Alive."
Yeah,
you know exactly. There you go. It sums it up right there.
And where are they out of?
Sweden.
They're a Swedish band. Okay, all right, yeah.
But I've always been a fan of Catatonia, moderately. But the last two records they've done, they've kind of had three phases. Their early stage, where they still have a bit of a death metal growl. Their middle stage, where it's become more experimental. Now it's almost like prog rock.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Okay. And it's kind of gothy, very creepy, beautiful and creepy in the same sense.
Yeah.
And very
strangely
gothy,
I know exactly
being,
what you mean
without being sissy about it. It's still gothy.
Okay,
which I do like some of that stuff. Typo Negative, for instance, I love the hell out of those guys. God, that was great.
Yeah,
it was like big tough Brooklyn guys. Yeah, always goth. What you gonna do about it? You know, what you gonna do about it?
He's huge.
Oh, he was
did
a big
you see
guy.
He played at the Mirage.
Seen him several times.
Yeah, I saw him play at the Mirage, and he was standing out in the crowd, and I was talking to him. He just standing there, he's just shirtless. And I'm just like, dude's huge.
Oh, yeah. He's a big guy. Yeah. Died way too young.
Yeah, he did.
Yeah, they were a fantastic band.
Yeah. He decided, you know, were you part of any of the conversations of him leading up to being that Anal Blast singer? Or did you, or was...
He considered calling the band Celluloid Death at one time. But that didn't happen. It ended up being Anal Blast. I thought Celluloid Death would have been a much better name for it, but...
but he went, else. I mean, he... I remember both of us were up there watching him. He was a hell of a front man.
He was
too.
Good.
I
really
did not
good.
Realize that he was that because he was so reserved when you'd see him outside.
You
know what I mean? It's just, you know.
He could either be the most gracious, polite, insightful, sensitive person, or he could just be this total fucking nightmare. This ogre. This BO smelling drunk ogre. You know, it was just.
Yeah.
And,
but I just remember seeing him on stage, and it's like, he really, I mean, he didn't need to do all that extra stuff to make, I mean, it helped, you know. I mean, he was just legitimately a good front man. He
was the lyrics were so immature, so Beavis and Butthead, so dumb.
They made
dumb in a good sense.
Look smart.
Yeah, I know. It's brilliant. You come up with a song that staple your puss lips together. It's just beautiful. And his intros to these songs, you're pulling in a trailer court and the trailer's rocking. You know what's going on. She's fucking around on you. You grab a staple hammer and you come in here, you put a couple on his head, and you staple her puss lips together. And he's. He was just down to an art, man. That was great.
Oh my God. You got Decker stories?
Hundreds of them.
You got some that you can share?
He's moved in on me many times, and I'd let him. He'd show up with a box of CDs and dirty metal T-shirts, and I'm gonna stay here for a while. Okay, fine. Like I said earlier, he's threatened to kill me, and then a minute later, he'll defend me. And
now, one thing I'd say to everybody is, I really love the metal way of life. I'm part of a club called the NYDM, and you know, the NYDM, we have cute little vests and patches and Super Decoder handshakes. And this patch, you know, it says New York Death Militia, but it's a unified group of people that support old school metal, black metal, death metal, power metal, grindcore, crust. It's led by Will Romer from Mortician, Randall, the international president from Decomposed. I'm the singer of Anal Blast. I fucking, people are confused about what we are, and here's what we are. We're fans of metal, and if you're a fan of metal, we're a fan of yours probably. You'll probably catch us listening to your fucking CDs if you see us at the shows. We support. That's what we do. If I had anything to say to all of you, we're all down here together. Black metal guys, death metal guys, hardcore guys, girls. We're like a brother and a sisterhood. There's one statement that I have from my chapter of the NYDM. Oh yeah, it's right here. It says, stand with your sisters, stand with your brothers, fuck all the others. All forms of metal stand together as one. And then we shit on each other drunk at the shows and backstab each other. And that's the fun part. Needless drama.
Love it when he'd get annoyed. He'd sit there and stew and just... then just let out like a howl like a tomcat. And tip the table over. And just he was something else.
Yeah.
Yeah, Decker. I miss that guy. He'd credit me for creating him. And all I did is just be kind to him. He was just a metal fan. That's all I saw him as.
Yep.
And he, like I said before, we'd do an out-of-town show, and Decker beat us there. You know, he'd talk someone else into driving him to Chicago or wherever else, you know. And we'd get to the venue, and Decker's already there. Yeah.
Really?
Yeah, he was enthusiastic about metal. That was his life. He really loved that. Yeah. One of the funnier things I remember about Decker, it was getting to be like early December, and it was frosty and a little cold out, and Decker, we were standing in one of them rental houses he had parties at, standing on the front step talking about something, and he's barefoot. And I go down, you're not wearing shoes, and they go, yeah, it's getting to be sock wearing weather. And then another time, it was early June, it was getting warm out, and he was wearing his winter pair of boots, and that was the only clothing he had except for a box full of metal T-shirts, an old pair of sweatpants, and these rubber boots, and they were starting to fall apart. And so I drove him to a Payless store, and he goes in, and the guy says, or it was a Walmart or somewhere. We come walking in, and they tell us at the door, you have to wear shoes to come in here. Well, that's when I come to fucking buy those shoes. and then we finally went to a place, and he's looking at a pair of work boots, beige colored, you know. And they were steel toed or something. he's looking at him, and he was unaware of the people standing around next to him. I won't say exactly what he did or the person that overheard him, but they got offended and grabbed their child and just ran away. And he said something about these boots. These would be good for kicking. Yeah. So it's very inappropriate, very Decker. Something else.
Where do you get the ideas for the American music?
Well, basically, we roll around on the floor and tickle ourselves in the stomach and come up with the dumbest possible things and then continue to bitch about it. Oh, God, we're being invaded.
Fuck,
it's Aaron
you.
T. Whitesides of Wrath / Anal Blast. So, guitarist and savior of the band, Pete from Slaughterbox right over here.
Oh, he's camera shy.
No, I'm not a camera
guy. Show your ass to the camera, man.
Just a little crap.
Yeah.
I remember going to Old Country Buffet with him and eating.
Oh, my God.
And they used to have those trays, and then you put your plate on there.
Yeah.
He wouldn't even bother with a plate. He'd just take that tray and just pile it full of ribs and bones and chicken and whatnot. And then we'd sit at a little table, and he'd pull another one next to him over. You know, what are you doing that for? This is the bone table.
just right on the table.
I remember going to Mystic Lake Buffet in the middle of the night with him, and they asked him to stop eating because he'd been through the line about 8 times. Yeah, Decker was something else. I don't think he ever thought in the back of his mind he'd ever set foot on stage. I thought he was probably happy enough just promoting shows and making a couple bucks.
Yeah.
And then it turned into, I guess the origin of that was he went to Des Moines for some show he promoted and befriended a couple guys that ended up in Slipknot and convinced them to move back to Twin Cities, and they lived at that shitty apartment in the ghetto on 38 in Chicago.
38 Chicago.
And
the upper level of
these two
upper
guys
half
from
of the
Wholesome Lily White Des Moines were probably freaked out.
That's
it was
half a block from Cup Foods where the George Floyd
crack
thing happened.
Crack deals going on. Yeah, exactly. That
I
same neighborhood.
There.
Yeah.
I went over there. Yeah.
They didn't last long. They moved back to Iowa, and then, like I said, 40 other people have taken a turn at being in Anal Blast. And, they were fun live. They really were fun live.
Yeah.
And I used to get off work at 4 in the afternoon, jump in the car, drive to town, do god-awful practice, and then turn around and come back and be home by like 12:30, 1 in the morning,
wow,
go to work the next day. And it was a lot of gas tanks and a lot of worn-out tires for a whole bunch of nothing. Horse labor.
Yeah.
They were wonderful. I love Terry Ingram, man. He had the best wit. He could just like shoot it out, just rapid fire. And I admired that. And I didn't quite have exactly what he had, but I admired what he'd done. And him and Bill Lindsay were a big influence on me.
Yeah.
To want to do it myself.
Yeah.
But Vile ruled. They were great. Mm. The short period of time they were around, that just kicked ass. That was great.
Because he went by Gilligan, right?
Yeah.
So it was him and Mr. Hate and Boy Bill and...
many people. Troy Stark, Deli was in that band for a while. He was in Disturbed for a while, too.
Yeah, you had a lot of bass players that went through.
Vince Trudell played with us for a while, Buffalo Head. Yeah. I like Vince. I thought he was a good, solid bass player.
Oh, yeah.
We did a lot of work with Brian Bart.
Yep.
Because
that's where you guys did Don't Expect Any Miracles with him.
Yeah.
He's great. He was great. He's still doing it, too.
I'm amazed how far that tape traveled. It really got around.
I know, right?
Yeah.
You ever look it up?
I've seen it on eBay for a couple $100.
I know,
I've seen
her
old T-shirts on eBay for a few $100. And
so, I know.
Like,
yeah. Well,
that was before internet.
It was all
snail mail.
And it was all elbow grease. The entire thing was elbow grease. There was nothing.
Some other metalhead in some other town, some other country liked it.
There wasn't anything handed to anybody. I mean, it was, you know.
And then you meet people that liked you back in the day, and they had a wrong idea. They thought, you know, you traveled in limos. They thought, you know, you just had naked women jumping out of cakes. You know, and it's just like, no, it wasn't like that, dude.
Wait a minute, you didn't have that?
You know. No, no, that never happened to us.
Yeah.
Who's the guy that did the punk fanzine that got big? Peter was his name. Anyway, he had Earl go do an interview with G.G. Allin. And he was staying at the fucking Shit Biscuits, the local band from Minnesota.
Okay, hold on. I'm glad that we're getting this part on
tape. Okay.
All right. You just blew. You just see that part of my brain that just like, what?
Yeah, so Earl just, Maximum Rock and Roll, is that the
yes,
name?
Yes,
yeah.
Maximum Rock and Roll.
And Earl wrote a little bit for him. And so he asked Earl to, he said, I'm going to go interview this guy named G.G. Allin. He's supposed to be really rude and offensive. You want to come with me? Sure, why not? It wasn't working at the time. It wasn't doing, you know. So we went and listened to this guy talk horror stories of all the crap that he's done. And then he played the entry a day or two later. And actually, before he left town, he stole a bunch of equipment from the Shit Biscuits. And wasn't a good house guest. But yeah, the show lasted about 15 minutes at the most. He comes out with a box, orange box, apple box you'd get at the grocery store.
Yeah, yeah.
Full of bottles of beer and small pints and little airplane-sized bottles of booze. Pours it out on the stage and half of them broke. So there's beer and broken glass on there, and he's picking up pieces of glass and cutting himself. People flick cigarettes at him. This is when you still smoke in a bar. He'd pick it up and put it out on his chest. He had all kinds of, like, half-healed scars all over him. Awful tattoos. My mother was a whore. And just, you know, just all kinds of just terrible jailhouse tattoos. And Earl and I went to go visit, interview him. I'll never forget that incident. Fanzines help keep the thing alive, and you just showed me a handful of stuff that you'd done back in the day, and I'd forgotten all about that. But if it wasn't, that was pre-internet days, and that was before then. You never found out about bands that were outside of your own town.
Yeah, well, yeah, you had to find it through the you had to mail people stuff.
Yeah, yeah, slow process, so, but.
So did you go do the interview with G.G. Allin?
Yeah, yeah.
And what was he like in person? Was he just crazy?
Or he sat and bragged about how offensive he was and how vulgar he could be. And you kind of sit there with your mouth half slack open. It's like, wow, dude, you're fucked up. But, yeah, the show, like I said, he cut himself, burned himself, took a few swings at people, a couple mic stands. He hit some girl in the crowd. And about 8 guys jumped on the stage and beat his ass and threw him down the staircase to the dressing room. End of the show. That was it. You know, so he was all bloody. Yeah, it was a mess.
Yeah. Yeah. I miss that. I miss that. Speaking of which, I miss that entry downstairs.
Yeah.
The dressing room. That felt like home, man. It's like you. You know.
Decker and I. Here's another Decker story. But Decker and I drank and smashed a case of Heineken in the basement in the dressing room. Made a fucking mess. The next morning I wake up and say, oh, we shouldn't have done that. Yeah. I better run down there and volunteer to clean it up. And we get there and we've already cleaned it up. And I even seen a post one time about McCullen complaining about that singer Earl had that fucker and Decker went and smashed a whole fucking case of beer down. I brought it up to him at Earl's funeral. That was you, huh? Fortunately, yeah. Yeah.
Was that wasted?
Yeah, I had many. Earl, in the final years of his life, he was tougher than hell.
Yeah.
I mean, he'd do a show. He'd have chemotherapy in the morning and do a show the same evening.
Wow.
And going through chemotherapy myself years later, I know how tough that must have been. But he was a trooper, man. He fought through it. I remember the last time I spoke to Earl live was about a week before he passed. And I came to town to see Opeth. And figured I'd best stop and see Earl. And he was in hospice care at home. And a guy that was taking care of him, a nurse, God, what is his name? Allen's his last name. Never met him before, but a nice guy. And he was taking care of Earl at home. And he was in a hospital bed. The Earl was still there, the spirit was still there, but yeah. The body had withered so much. It was disturbing to see it. Yeah. And I'd see him like every 2 months or so. I'd stop and visit him in the hospital or at home, depending upon how well he was.
Yeah.
And it was always sad to see his health deteriorate further and further. The last time I saw him, he was basically in two pieces held together by flesh. His pelvis had broken into two pieces, but held together by tissues. He was on a lot of painkillers and whatnot. Oh. But his spirit and attitude is still there.
Yeah.
And I remember he gave me a box of videotape of old Disturbed stuff. And as I walked out the door, I stumbled and dropped him, and he laughed about that. But I got out to my car and cried like a little kid. It was just a guy that used to be as big as a mountain and strong is now in two parts and withering really fast. And the night that he did die, I was at work. I was working a night shift. And I just was feeling uneasy. And I knew it was getting close to the bitter end from what I had heard from other people. And Eric Freitag called me. And I went outside and had a smoke and talked to him for about 25 minutes or so. And he had heard that Earl was fading rapidly. Mm-hmm. So we were just talking about him, and both of us felt just kind of crummy about it. And this is like 11 at night. And I guess his official leaving us was like 11:30, wrong man. Between 11 and 11:30, he died. And we both just had this overwhelming feeling of sorrow. Yeah. And then I talked to, like I mentioned, John Sweat. He was an original member in the original Disturbed. And he lives in Denver now. And he came back for that memorial for Earl. And he said the same thing, and he's like, you know, 10 hours away, 12 hours away, hadn't seen the guy in 10 years or better. And just that evening, just had this overwhelming rush of sorrow come over him for no apparent reason. And it was roughly the same time. Another person I knew that was knew Earl well and lived in Omaha and hadn't seen him in years either, said the same thing. He was with friends that night, and then roughly about that time of the night, just felt sad. So I think Earl, on his way out the door, tapped a few people on the shoulder and said, "Well, I'll see you in Valhalla."
Yeah.
You know, and when I got the news the next morning, John Mytich, who was a former member of God Awful Disturbed, called me and said, "Yeah, Earl died last night." And it's like, "Oh, okay, well, let me know if you hear any funeral arrangements or whatever." And I hung up the phone, and again, I just broke down into tears, just cried. And I usually try to hold it together, and a big metal tough guy shit, you're not going to bawl. But yeah, I just couldn't help myself. It just overwhelmed the sadness. So.
Yeah.
The guy's thought enters my mind every day.
Yeah.
We didn't see eye to eye on certain things. Most of the stuff we did, but we butted heads about things. Mm-hmm. I think towards the end of the Disturbed's career, I took a lot of the responsibility of booking shows.
Okay.
Earl had a million irons in the fire and had a hard time controlling them all.
Mm-hmm.
But that's the way he operated, and I didn't have enough irons in the fire. I just had a fire. That's about it. But so I took on the booking responsibilities. Yeah, there's not a day that goes by I don't think about him.
Yeah.
He had a great sense of humor.
Yeah.
Very intelligent person. Learned a lot from him. I had a way of keeping him from blowing up. If you've ever seen a Earl having a fit, we actually printed stickers. It had the DRI logo, and it had, you know, the guy moshing.
Yeah, yeah.
And he had a bottle of beer in one hand and a flying V in the other. And it had DRI, but it was a drunk root incident. And I had a way of keeping him from blowing a stack. But yeah, we best of friends. Yeah, I mean, a true friend will punch you in the mouth.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and that's happened more than once or twice. And you know, an average, common, just someone you see every once in a while, I ain't gonna do that. But yeah, I'm running out of things to say. I just don't.
I understand. I didn't want to interrupt because in case you wanted to, but he had such a huge footprint
Oh yeah, on that on yeah. this whole entire scene, and I've always, you know, because he had the star at First
yeah,
Avenue.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, and
Troy
and,
Deli or Troy Stark had a lot to do with getting that arranged. So,
oh, that was Troy that
yeah,
did that.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, he was part owner of Seville right across the street. So
that's right. I ran into him. I think it was at the Impaler show, the Impaler's 40th anniversary. So.
Yeah.
Yeah, still looks exactly the freaking same. It's like, how come you didn't age?
Troy's done well for himself.
Yeah.
He really has.
He's done good. But yeah, so I've had this, you know, ever since then. And mm-hmm. I've always kept it, you know, displayed. It's either been on our fireplace or, you know, whatever. And it reminds me, and all my kids know about Earl and, you know, how important he was and everything. And
yeah, he was. Early on... And this is still when the cover band poser thing, excuse me if anyone was associated with that league, but that's what exactly what it was. They kind of looked down on him or us.
Yeah.
Have you anything to say?
Huh?
Have you anything to say?
Do I have anything to say? Blow me.
And in hindsight, we knocked the fucking snot out of you as far as attendance goes and respect goes and national and worldwide attention.
Yeah.
Big deal if you could attract 120 stupid girls in high heels to Mr.
They were
Nibs.
Cute though. They were cute.
Huh?
The girls were a lot cuter though.
Well, I had no problem with that myself, but yeah, I remember people looked down their nose or snidely at us for that shit. And it's like, yeah, well, at least we're not out there fucking up Van Halen Loverboy songs. We're writing our own music, so
Earl was really important to me.
Yeah.
You know, Earl was the first radio station that I went mm-hmm. on. Earl was the guy that I continued to talk to about metal after I had left the scene. He was the guy that you'd stop into the record store. Maybe it was just after the state fair or whatever, and you'd stop in the record store and you'd talk to Earl, and it was like you saw him yesterday. And there was, you know, he was always...
Wonderful person.
Always happy to meet you. You know, he and I were the only one that attended the metal thing, the Morticia reunion at some like club underground or something like that. And
I was at the radio station for the very first, it wasn't even the Root of All Evil back then. There was this girl that went to school at Brown Institute and for radio broadcasting. And she got in there for like 3 hours on Friday nights. And, didn't quite have metal figured out quite. Her name was Angela. And Iron Maiden played the Met that night. And Earl dropped me off. No, I didn't go to the very first one, but the reason I brought this up, he borrowed a handful of records. Got any records I could use tonight for this radio program? I said, yeah, take your pick. And he thumbed through a handful and grabbed him. Never seen him back again. Seen one in his store. He had an autographed record of Queensryche that was for sale in his store. It's like, whatever. Didn't even own a turntable at the time, so it's like, whatever. But yeah, she stumbled over her own mouth and played some really dopey music, and Earl went in to save the show, and 2 weeks later, it was his show. She bowed out. So.
And then, you know, and then I was looking at, you saw the thing for the Root of All Evil in that fanzine. It says for the past 3 years. So is it 87 was when he...
Yeah.
Wow. See, I thought he'd been doing it for...
Disturbed started in 87.
Years and decades before, but yeah, no. But we went on there. That was
there
like
was
the first couple of years.
There was a few people that had metal programs, and there's this Bang Your Head, a guy named Willie the Lizard that did that prior. Another guy named Vince Wallander that played... It was more hardcore and stuff, but he did play some metal. He was a roommate of mine at one time.
Yeah.
So there was a little bit on the radio prior to Earl, but Earl kind of set it in stone. That,
I mean, and then between all the shows and all the bands that were come, it just kept growing, and growing, and it turned into.
Yeah,
its
own great
thing.
How it grew. It there was a time period in the '90s where it kind of bellied up, at least in my eyes, it kind of did, and then it went underground and came and resurfaced again, heavier and more brutal. And in a way, that had to happen. It was almost like a forest fire to clean out and start anew.
To rebuild the nutrients in the soil.
Yeah, and even the forest fire that started it didn't last long. The Smashing Pumpkins Nirvana period Pearl Jam period really didn't last that long.
No, it was a few years.
And I could never figure out alternative was an alternative to talent. You know, I could never. I just wasn't into it. And you can one thing at this year's Metal Fest I'd never seen done before. Municipal Waste played, and they're a fun vomit party type band. Yeah. And I'm not familiar. I got like their first two discs, but I'm not familiar with their most current shit. But there must be a song about garbage. Well, the band's named Municipal Waste for one. And so every fucking big industrial strength size garbage can in that whole room got thrown into the pit. So there's garbage cans surfing all over the place. Some of them would end up on the stage. The singer would whip it back out, and cups and crap and cans would go flying. And then when they were done, the floor kind of cleared out, and there's junk one end to the other, just crap all over. Beautiful. I thought that was wonderful.
I've never seen that before.
Yeah, it was garbage can surfing. Yeah. Nick from Disturbed, when he left Minnesota, he went to Montreal, Canada, and played at Cataclysm.
Yeah.
They were just here recently, I think, with Cryptopsy, or no, who was it? Decapitated or something? And
now,
Nick lives in Nebraska, married with children.
Is he playing still?
He's in a band called The Weird.
Nice.
I have yet to hear it, but I went to Oklahoma a few weeks ago, and on my way back, I was going to stop and Oha and have lunch with them, but complications kept that from happening. So
yeah. Life happens.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I remember he came from Nosferatu, didn't he?
They were great. God. Yeah.
So fast.
Yeah, he was good.
Literally, he was so
I remember seeing Nosferatu. Mark, who's another guy that's no longer with us, Mark Manriquez from Omaha, that was a member of Nosferatu, approached me at a show he did with Death at the Varsity. Or was it somebody? I can't remember. Yeah. Sepultura or somebody.
A Decker show?
Yeah, and handed me a tape and a card and said, hey, I'm in a band from Omaha, and we'd like to play up here sometime, and if you could help us out, and, you know, great. So I kept the card, kept the tape, and Decker was setting up something at the Varsity with bands from the area, Eau Claire, Milwaukee, Des Moines, Fargo, wherever the case might be, within a few hours distance.
Yeah.
And you know about anybody in Omaha? And I said, matter of fact, I do. I'll go dig up his number. So I call him on the phone, said, you remember talking to me at a show at the Varsity Theater in Minneapolis? Well, we're doing this Metal Fest thing.
Yeah.
Do you guys be interested? There's no pay. You'd be interested in coming up and doing it? And said, yeah, sure. I don't think I bothered to even listen to the tape before. It's just another band from out of town. Yeah. You can get proof that they're not from here. So, and not from here. But then after seeing him live, I was like, Nick was amazing, man. Oh, God, he was fucking good. And
almost like unbelievably good.
So when Jason left, we auditioned a handful of guys. A guy I remember, Nick, I believe his name was from Insidious Prophets, came and
auditioned. Oh, yeah, Nick
Poshak. Yeah. Who else showed up? Ken Boyle.
Okay.
It was with Jeff. Jeff
yep, from Game Hens.
Yeah. And then I said, remember that guy from Nebraska that played a million miles an hour? I'm going to get a hold of him. So I called him. He's living with his parents. He's only like 18 at the time, 19 maybe. They said, hey, this is Jim Odegard. I'm in a band in Minneapolis. We played together once. Yeah, it's a Metal Fest thing. And would you be interested in coming up and auditioning? Okay. And this is when Roadrunner was talking to us, and mm-hmm. Metal Blade and Peaceville and whoever these labels
were. Yeah.
Which I'm almost glad we didn't get signed to it, because that would have prolong my childhood. Kept this going a lot longer and expected to be more places for less money, and
yeah.
I just wasn't feeling it at the time.
Somebody anyway, telling you what to do.
So I called Nick, and he agreed. So Jason, Jay Jaquist of Shred Fit, and he had a pickup, so we rode down to Omaha, picked him up, moved him back up here, and he lived with me for quite a long time. And I almost felt bad about uprooting this kid from his parents' house, but it turned out to be a good thing.
Yeah.
But then it was actually short-lived. I only think Nick was in a band a year and a half before I was the first guy to step away.
Yeah.
I just had had my fill of it. And you, like I said, you can see the writing on the wall. Yeah. Also, after I left, they got a band called themselves Sick, which is a clever name, you know, in grammar.
Yep.
I was working Sick with... in brackets means misuse of a word, which is, I think, great, the misuse of words. But Eric Freitag took the singing position, which I was happy to hand a torch off to him.
Yeah.
Great. And when he told me, he said, I hope you don't mind, but I'm singing for those guys now. Couldn't have found a better guy to do it. I'm happy for you. If you can knock yourself out, I don't care.
Yeah.
So.
And that was a short run for them, though. But I didn't. Yeah. So Eric was the singer for that the whole time?
Yeah. And that's kind of why I bowed out, because it was no longer. We were thrash metal that started to border on death.
Mm-hmm.
We weren't total death, but it was the beginning of that whole era. And it just turned into something I was unfamiliar with.
Yep.
And then, like I said, the forest fire happened of alternative music, and metal died briefly. Yeah. I enjoyed the early death metal, but it became so complicated, so technical. You almost had to have a PhD in advanced math to understand it, you know? And you could see the writing on the wall. It was over.
You remember Cromlech?
Oh, yeah.
I think that they started surfing
we
into that.
We butted had something awful. And Decker had something to do with that. I think he had something to do with watching the fur fly from a distance.
Okay, yeah.
But now, when I run across...
Don,
or what was the other guy's name? Robertson. You know, everything's fine. You know, water under the bridge, ancient history, you know.
Yeah.
they were really good at what they did.
Oh, yeah.
They were one of the first death metal bands, true death metal bands of this town. My dad come to see us play a couple of times. Yeah. And my dad was an art teacher. And so he understood the artistic aspect of it. And I did all the graphic design, the logo designs, and flyers, posters, whatever else, tape covers for the band. So at least you're doing that, you know.
Did you come up with the broken glass?
Yeah.
That was you?
Yeah, oh, the face cool. thing too, all that
shit.
Oh,
okay. Right on.
So my dad come to see us play a couple different times. And one was at the Varsity Theater. I think that was that show I was telling you about that I first seen Nick Miller play. And we had all these different bands from the Midwest area. And two guys show up. My uncle and my father show up to the... And they're two conservative-looking older guys. And they had, you know, dress pants on and...
polo shirts.
probably a regular dress shirt, and it was early spring, so they were wearing like beige trench coats. And they show up, so we're looking for Jim Odegard, and the guys at the door thought police. He's an undercover police, so they let him in. And he's in here somewhere, and then I'm backstage, and someone goes, "Yeah, there's a couple cops out here looking for you." Cops? What are you talking about? So I kind of go and peek around the corner of the curtains. Yeah, those two old guys in the back there in the corner. Oh, that's my dad and uncle. They come to see us play. But my mother never, she's an Aunt B.
Yeah.
She's, you know, I wasn't going to expose this shit to her. She thought we played wedding dances and marmitzvahs, and we'll just let her think that. You know, I wasn't going to expose that to her. And so she had no clue what we did.
Never heard your stuff or anything?
No, I didn't want her to.
Either. Yeah.
She wouldn't understand. She would have been shocked. My sister came to see us a few times, and she was into theater. She got a degree in theater. She understood that aspect of it.
But, yeah. Yeah. There wasn't a lot of people that did understand back in those days of what we were doing.
Sucks to be them. We got along fine without them, didn't we?
It was fun. Oh, my God. Yeah. It was so much fun. Okay, so metal. Okay, so it's 1988. Who has the idea for Metal's for Man's Best Friend? Who comes up with that?
Because
I remember the front leaders were you, Earl.
Well,
and
I
Jimmy
think
McHurl.
Steve McCullum, First Avenue, propositioned McHurl and Earl about, can you guys organize something?
Oh, really? Okay, yeah. So that was his.
And
then
everyone's got a soft spot for animals, so we chose that for.
Yep. If you were starting right now, what path would you take? Would you
if I could, I've always been a huge fan of prog rock.
Yeah.
And
Like, what are some bands that you would...
Oh, I grew up on, like, you know, Emerson, Lake and Palmer, Yes, yeah. Pink Floyd, Kansas.
Yeah.
And I'm really into, like, Devin Townsend now. Opeth, from their Growly period to their Jethro Tull period. Ian Anderson, I guess, is doing vocals on their newest record.
Oh, from the Cults. Or no, Ian Anderson's from...
Jethro Tull.
Jethro Tull. Oh!
And a band called So On. I think it's how it's pronounced. Haken, they're an English band, very proggy. I would love to have done something like that. Early Genesis, I love the hell out of that stuff.
Really? Really?
Oh, fuck yeah. I go see Peter Gabriel every time he comes to town. He's amazing.
Wow, that's cool.
I've always liked that style of music, like Catatonia we were talking about earlier. It's kind of goth, it's kind of prog, it's kind of dark, it's kind of melancholy. I don't know how you'd there's all kinds of different influences, yeah. But it's all up my alley.
Yeah. Well, that's awesome. Like that. So I wouldn't expect that.
I'm going to go see John Anderson, the singer of Yes, up in St. Cloud at that amphitheater.
Oh, okay.
He's got a band called The Band Geeks. And I've seen video of them, and it's spot on. Note for note, just amazing. And
I've seen Yes before.
Oh, God. I didn't care for the 80s version of Yes.
You didn't like Owner of a Lonely Heart?
With Donny Osmond? Yeah, I didn't really care for them much.
No.
It was good, but it wasn't Yes. They did a couple tours in the last 25, 30 years with the original lineup, or close to the original lineup as possible. But not the original lineup either, the most successful lineup.
Okay.
But I've always loved that sort of stuff. So, yeah, if I could do it all over again, I would like to do that. And I think, just when I think back in hindsight, when God Awful finally fell apart, I had the music scene figured out. Yep. I had the business of music figured out, but that didn't have the age or the desire or... It's just, I'm done.
Yeah.
I'm done.
You stopped.
Retired. Yeah, I stopped. Yeah.
Yeah.
Another singer I've always admired, and you would have had your metalhead card revoked for admitting to this back in the late 80s, was David Coverdale. But I've always been a big fan of Deep Purple.
Okay.
But that guy had the most, and I've never thought that way about men, but he had the most sensual voice ever. Same with Peter Steele of Typo Negative.
Yeah, yeah.
You put that on, you know you're going to get some nookie, and you're going to get your hair pulled and your back scratched up good. It's just guys like that could actually really sing.
Yeah.
Devin Townsend is amazing. That guy is just godly, his talents.
Really?
It's just incredible. Yeah, if you're not familiar with it, look him up. He's biggest unkept secret of the 90s. Still around today. Now, you've heard of Strapping Young Lads, haven't you?
I've heard of them.
Yeah, he did that, but he just grew tired of metal.
Yeah.
And when God Awful first started up, we were kind of going about it as a both Earl and I were really into Sanctuary and Nevermore.
Okay.
And we kind of want to do something along them lines, because we had done thrash, we'd done Borderland Death, and want to do something along those lines. So the first two or three shows we did, I was trying to pull off that vocal style, and I was succeeding at it, but personally I didn't think I was pulling it off as well as I could have. Okay. And then, you know, we started... just to have time to fill, start doing old Disturbed songs. And then, like I said, we painted ourselves into a corner, and it's like the crowd response of the 20-year-old songs is better than the brand new stuff.
Oh, yeah.
So the brand new stuff got altered to go back to the old schnauzer vocal style I used to have. The mad German dog.
But yeah, you used to come in. I mean, you that was your stage when you came out. That was your stage, and I remember being in the crowd, and everything combined with Disturbed made me want to just run into people. To be perfectly honest with you, when I hear the beginning of Cease to Exist, I'm just like, even to this day, I want to kind of push somebody over.
You know? Yeah. Well, also when you, like Cease to Exist, for instance, had a long introduction,
mm-hmm.
like it grew. And what am I going to do? Look at my shoes? Yeah. So you had to say something. So you had to incorporate, and like I said, the cheerleader aspect. You had to engage the crowd to be on your side and get enthusiastic about it and crank them up and get them whipped up a little bit. Yeah. And that's something I learned throughout time. At first, I didn't have that. It's just kind of a skill you obtain through life. And like I said, you know, I learned from Terry Ingram, from Vile, learned from Bill, from Impaler. You learn from the best. Like I said, you know, Roger Daltrey, Jimmy Page, or Robert Plant, or you just learn from other guys. You know, Peter Steele, whatever the case might be. Yep. You just learn the art of showmanship.
Yep.
And I wasn't a singer; I was a performer.
Yeah. Yep.
So
and you know it's interesting how many people bring up Bill as being a
he's a legend.
I think that would be really good.
The very first thing we started the camera is you mentioned a legend in the metal community, and I'm is Bill Lindsay in the room? It ain't me. Eric, you got to get you on, even if you can't come to town. Do it Skype or however.
Yeah, exactly.
Eric, we got to hear your story.
We
got to
find out what's going on with Eric and see.
I learned from him. I learned quite a bit from him.
Just to go.
Oh God! But he
was it called the Iowa mating call? Okay.
Iowa, downtown Des Moines at 2 in the morning. It's echoing all over the place.
Yeah. Anyways, Jimmy, I really appreciate you coming in.
Thanks for having me on, man.
This is going to be is going to be fun.
It's good reminiscing about a lot of ancient histories.
So. I know. It's great. We did a lot of stuff together. And, you know, I was happy to be
We changed the world.
We did.
Only changed Minneapolis.
One drunk teenager at a time.
But other than that,
one drunk teenager at a time.
Yeah. Shit. I was 27 years old and I finally got on stage.
What?
I'm 63 fucking years old.
Well,
man.
I'm 57.
I wish I'd give a left nut to be your age. I'd probably still need it. But, but
you were 27 when you hopped up there. I was I was 20. I was 20.
Yeah, I was 27 years old and I finally got on stage.
Oh, yeah. Andy was 15, I think. Yeah, young kids.
Yeah. You guys were young. Yeah. Well, people don't believe everything that was said. but quite a bit of it was fabricated and sugar-coated and polar punches a little bit. But it's a pleasure being here with you.
Yeah, it was amazing. I'm so glad. And, you know, we'll do it again, too. I mean, really, for real. It's. I'm not good at ending these things, so.
That's it. Enough.
Dun, dun, dun,
dun, Don't do dun, something with your dun. Life. Quit watching us.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't.
Thank you. Why?